This week on the AwesomeCast, Mad Mike joins us from New York. In the studio, we talk about Chrome sticks, Chromecast games, Slack, and so much more. Stay tuned, AwesomeCast.
Find yourself in the Beachview area of Pittsburgh? Check out the official pizza of this show, Slice on Broadway, sharing an abnormal obsession with pizza we can relate to. Check them out at sliceonbroadway.com and tell them this show sent you.
Hey guys, it's the AwesomeCast coming at you live from Pittsburgh, PA, in the Mayhem Studio. I'm Mike Sorg, at Sorgatron on Twitter, ready to get geeky, talk tech, have some fun with me in studio. So many people in studio! Look! First of all, of course, the regular co-host with the most from Studio A is John Chilla at Chilla on the Twitters.
How's it going?
Good, good.
Hey, how
good.
About, so for work, we have to do like a remote cam for some of our, some of our WebExes, mm-hmm. and I'm actually using Studio B for my cam for work.
Nice.
That's the name. It'll be down in the lower left-hand corner. So nice. I'll be perpetually at Studio B at work.
And also in studio, he normally resides from Poughkeepsie, New York. He is Mad Mike, who joins us usually on the Wrestling Mayhem Show. How you doing, Mike?
I'm doing good, Sorg. How are you?
Good, good, good. Hit tech angle, he's a chemical engineer, folks, and he's single.
Ladies.
I guess, should we plug, you're looking for a job in Pittsburgh?
Yeah, pretty much. I'm looking to get back out there. Had some rough personal issues, but I'm trying to relocate from New York to Pittsburgh.
There you go. So if anybody has got a lead on something that sounds very important and chemically and engineering, please get at us or at him at MadMike4883 on Twitter. We'd love to help through the Mayhem Nation here, get him to Pittsburgh, so he can join us in the studio and have some Slice on Broadway more often, right?
Oh, I love Slice on Broadway. I know we're not at the ads yet, but I've already had two slices.
It's a life ad. But anyways, this is the AwesomeCast. You can check us out at awesomecast.net. We have a lot of interviews with the Awesome Chat. Actually, just recorded tonight a really cool interview talking about Tech Shop Pittsburgh. With Les Geis over there, and he actually took his iPad and did a tour with us of the facility and all the cutters and laser cutters and 3D printers and others, the wood shop and all kinds of stuff going on over there. So look for that later this week over on the website. And you can also follow us on social media and subscribe to us on iTunes, on Stitcher's, all kinds of places, the YouTube video and audio formats. And please check us out every Tuesday around 6:30 to 7. We get started p.m. Eastern time at live.sorgatronmedia.com. You can join us in there. Crazy Kraus, who's going to be joining us in studio next week, is in there as well as a few other friends. Oh, Wheels is in there too. And of course, our community manager for the night, Missy, wife of the show, is joining us. So thank you all for that. And also, hey, big thanks to our Patreon supporters. And I realize I need to pull something up. Something really cool is going to our executive producers this week. But thanks to our friends at Thistle C Business Development, at Thistle C on the Twitter, and the Mike Fedor Show, our executive producer level Patreons. That means they're given $5 or more. And I did promise that if you were on the executive producer level, after a month of doing that, you would get some fancy pants new business cards in the mail, and those have come out. Excuse me, cough button. And if I have a picture of a video coming up here very soon. Oh, there they are. You ready for this? Kabow! Some sweet, awesome cast executive producer
Bam!
Cards coming at you. The hosts don't even have this.
They're pretty awesome, Sorg. They're pretty awesome. I got to see them in person. They
look
really good.
You did. So again, you can go follow the show at patreon.com/awesomecast. And if you don't want to throw us a couple bucks for supporting the show, there's a lot of levels there, and we have some special stuff for you on there on the higher levels. You can just share the show. Please get the word out there. People, especially in the Pittsburgh area and anywhere else, you just want a little bit of a flyover state mentality, people using this stuff all the time. So let's get into it with our awesome things of the week. Guys, I want to talk about Chromecast. I had a lazy Sunday night a little bit. After going out and doing some stuff, getting some work done and hanging out at the movies with my mom, to be honest. Yeah. As we were talking about peanuts earlier here before the show, but, and I just kind of saw it and started poking at some stuff. And unfortunately, the widely promised, Chromecast games that we've heard about are not out there, but there's a few that have been out there for a little bit and I never really had a chance to dive into them. But of course, Angry Birds Go is one that when they did the Chromecast 2 announcements, like that's when they showed off, mm-hmm. right? And you know, I'm really excited about the opportunity to do that. And we played some Chromecast games, and I'm like, yeah, they're okay. But we started poking around a little bit, and I kept downloading them and sending the link to Missy over in the chair. I said, here, download this. No, just download this. You're going to play this with me. And we tried Scrabble Blitz, and it's a very quick. Here's some letters. How many words can you make out of it? And of course, I should have known better than to challenge my wife to that, because I got destroyed pretty handily after that. But also, there was like a Monopoly World Tour where you just have to get one of every property because they're passports. And it's a nice graphical Monopoly board on screen and everything. And then also, I tried a little bit of Just Dance Now.
How'd that work?
That it's so. One, I cheated because I was laying on the couch and I just moved my hand because it's like the Wii where it's just the accelerometer in your one hand, and it's so I cheated at that, but still I see the possibility here if you actually play along to it, and they give you like 5 free songs. But aside from that, there's buying songs like through coins or whatever, or you pay like $40 a year and you just get all songs, which is kind of nice. Actually,
that is really nice.
I think in the long run, I think it's very accessible. For something like that, but great, I don't have to go get them on my Wii or something and go bring my Wii down and hook that thing up to my TV, right? I don't know, I think it's a pretty cool use of that. And I saw some other interesting ones, like there's a pig, it looks kind of like Flappy Birds, but you're a pig, and what it's supposed to be is there's a fitness version of it where you set up your iPad or your phone so it sees the camera, and I think you actually actively flap, and it sees that as a motion and makes the pig flap as well.
That sounds very tiring.
It does, and it'll actually broadcast that to the TV. You don't have to use a TV, but it's better if you're gonna like sit your phone down and kind of do it that way. Worked pretty okay. Things seemed laggy. Because I wondered how much of these graphical things were just streaming from the phone a little bit. I'm not sure entirely how it works. And when it's loading stuff, is it loading stuff from the internet or is it loading it stuff like over the Wi-Fi from my phone when it does that? Because it has to load an app into the Chromecast, right? So I wonder how much that is loaded over onto there. Is it my Wi-Fi? Is it my phone? Or is it or is it because I have the slower Chromecast now at this point? But I don't know.
Did you play Pong?
Pong?
They have Pong, I see.
Did not play with Pong.
Did you play Emoji Party?
No. That's one that's been on my list, actually, to play.
Emoji Party has Batman on it.
Yes, it does.
Mm-hmm.
Yes,
Emoji Party the movie.
Guess the movie. Okay.
That's cool.
That looks like fun.
That does look like fun.
And we've
is
done...
that Princess Leia?
Mm-hmm.
Karate Kid?
I believe that is the dude from The Big Lebowski.
That is the dude.
So they're just like emoji pictures of movies, right? And you have to figure them out?
That's what it looks like.
Is that Lulu?
That's, I'm guessing.
Yeah. And actually, here it is here for you guys on video to check out.
That's Doc Brown.
And I assume that is Daniel's son.
So, and we've played with...
let's close the show down. Let's stop
and
go
do
play.
The emoji party. But there's another... early on, there was like somebody just made this app and it was like a beta one with the Cards Against Humanity. It was a visualized Cards Against Humanity where you picked your cards, they're on your phone, and then they revealed them on the TV, basically, right?
Oh, I was going to say, I hope they're not visualizing things around the cards because that would be disturbing to an obscene amount of levels.
I believe it was called Dehumanize Your Friends because they got in trouble. They got in trouble because of the names. Because you can actually do... you can actually do anything with the cards. They're open source for Cards Against Humanity, but I don't think they could use the name officially. But
yeah, they said you can make any kind of apps you want with it. You just can't monetize it.
Right, exactly. And I think they just had an issue when they started using that same name. So no, go look for that. It's on. I think it's on both Google and Android and iOS. So you can go check that out as well. I mean, it was a little buggy. Like we got like we played through all the cards and then it started kind of crashing at one point. But definitely worth checking out. So Chilla, what is your
Build on your Chromecast and gaming?
Keep it Google.
Let's keep the Goog in the news. Mine is ASUS has released their Chromebit. And if you remember back probably around the time of CES, we were talking there were some different devices that were coming out that were kind of pretty much like a HDMI computer on a thumbstick.
And we were just like, what happened to this?
Yeah, so the first one of the first ones that came out or one of the first ones announced out of CES was the Chromebit. It's an $85 dual core, 2 gig of RAM, 16 gig of storage space, Chrome OS device on a stick. So you got an open HDMI port on a computer monitor or your TV. You can plug this in.
Like, wait. Is this comparison the size to a Snickers bar? About the same size of a Snickers bar, basically.
It doesn't look as thick as the Snickers bar. It's about the same length.
I was gonna say, what does Chrome act like when it doesn't have a Snickers bar?
But keep in mind, it does need to. You do need to plug power into it, and it does have an option for using a full size USB port.
Mm-hmm.
So the USB port, you can plug a hub into that. You can plug your mouse and keyboard, and more space, whatever. Or you can pair up Bluetooth keyboard and mouse. The device is getting decent reviews around performance. They're not saying this isn't a replace for a streaming type device like a Roku or an Apple TV. They said you're not getting the quality out of the Netflix stream that you probably would in a Chrome tab.
Mm-hmm.
But it is good as just your basic browser window. I'm guessing games much like you're talking about that are low intensive. Your typical Chromebook type tasks, right? As well as having the Chrome OS library of applications.
Right. There's a lot of kind of in browser games that are plenty suitable for a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
On Chrome browsers and Chromebooks. So I don't know, it's a possibility.
One of the cool things that I thought about using this for was I actually have started to use Chrome Remote Desktop on a lot of my machines at home. So I use Chrome's browser plugin as a remote desktop host, kind of like we used to. Team Studio replaced Logman. Mm-hmm. For a lot of people, Chrome has that built in if you want to use it. So you could pretty much take this anywhere, and if you can find an HDMI port, you could remote back into your house. And I'm using that a lot at work, so I would think even at work I have an open HDMI port on the back of my monitor. So I could plug this in and kind of go to town with remoting back into my house, which would then, as long as it can screen scrape fast enough, I could do things like fire up iMovie or fire up anything that's running off the host.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause the only thing it's grabbing is screens, right? So if I needed to take a video, I could throw it up on Dropbox or throw it up somewhere, remote into home, do my editing, clipping stuff out, and then pull it back down. And all I have to carry around is this little HDMI stick.
You're good to go?
I'm good to go.
I like it.
For $85,
tempting.
I mean.
It's tempting. Like, again, it's kind of like $85 and you basically have a computer. Man, that's tempting. I don't know. There could be some really interesting ideas for something like this. You know, I think about they just installed, you know, for instance, by one client, they just installed some TVs and they have an Apple TV on the back. And they're like, well, now we can send stuff from the iPad to the thing. It's like, well, if you use this thing, then you can just play YouTube straight on it. You know what I mean? And not even have to do that streaming thing. Just mm-hmm. let it do its thing. And that's it.
The new Apple TV has YouTube on it. You can set up a channel and put it on a loop.
Well, there's that too. No, not even for that. I mean, for education. Like,
oh, okay.
We want to show videos. And all of our videos, mm-hmm. for the most part, go on YouTube or something like that. Anyways, it just kind of makes sense. You know, put like a slim form factor DVD player on the back or something like that too for DVDs they want to show maybe. So I mean, it seems fine enough. So but no, I think definitely, and even for even for a little bit of that, you know, like you say, like that's the slideshow idea that you had you mentioned. Like, there's got to be something in like Google Slides or something where you can just do a slideshow, right?
I'm sure you could set it up in their presentation app.
So wouldn't that be great?
And just put it.
Because right now we have an iPad hooked up to the TV, and I have to like take the iPad, take it to my computer, which is across the street, by the way, and connect it, update the slides, and I put them in the in a folder on in Photos, and then we and the only photos on there, and I use the slideshow function on the lock screen, and it goes. Cool, we're good to go, right? It's just a pain to update, and I'd love it to be a little more, a little less cumbersome. So
here's
also $85 dongle versus a $400 iPad. I mean, it's kind of that kind of works out, doesn't it?
So the one thing that I would urge you for that exact use case is there's a dashboard app for iOS. And it's called my dashboard. No,
I have a feeling you're going to be giving me a link later.
I'll be giving you a link.
Yeah, we'll look into that.
The dashboard will let you point to a directory on Dropbox or wherever, and you could from here, you could kick out those files, and it would.
This is happening. We're looking at this.
The cool thing about dashboard too is I've used it at work because you can set it up. You set up dashboard with all the stuff you want. So you could set up 10 RSS feeds for it to monitor, and you can set it up for Twitter and to do a bunch of different things in different panels on the screen and point it towards a graphic source. And it just keeps updating the dashboard. I like very, that. Very cool app.
Well, we're looking at that one.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Yep. I'm a huge fan of it. Now I'll get you the correct application name.
We'll have to share that on Twitter as well. Follow AwesomeCast on Twitter, Facebook. We'll try to get it out for you. Mad Mike.
Yes.
Mad Mike. Mike Rosen.
My awesome thing. Now Sorg, you've known me a while, right?
A little bit. I don't know how long I've been doing a podcast.
Almost 10 years.
Yes. Almost 10 years, apparently.
Yeah. So I had always been a flip phone guy. Always been a flip phone guy.
You're the longest running flip phone user I know of that isn't a wrestling promoter.
A great tragedy happened. I was in a cab earlier this year, and it fell out of my pocket. And I lost my phone. So I had to get a new phone. And moving away from the Goog, the iPhone 6, it's just fantastic. Like, and it's so... My sister had always had iPhones, and I had never really had one because I had my iPad Mini or an iPod Touch or something just to get me through.
That was your gateway to iOS.
Yeah,
without having to invest in it.
Yeah, but like I've appreciated this phone so much in just the few months that I've had it that me and my sister also convinced my mother to get an iPhone, and she decided to go one better than the both of us and got an iPhone 6S Plus.
Oh, jeez.
With a huge, like, blinged out cover and everything like that. And it's just amazing. Like, just being able to teach her stuff, like, now that I know how to use the phone, because she had I don't even remember what kind of phone it was because I wasn't there when they bought it. But it was just a horrible, horrible Android-based phone that would crash all the time, that would download spam apps for jewelry districts and stuff like that. I don't even know, but... I just really, really like not having a flip phone anymore. I've joined the dark side, and I've convinced my mother to do it too. So
welcome to the future, and skipping about 10 years of technology to get there. I like that.
You didn't even have to go through the Palm Trio days or BlackBerry days.
You didn't even have to go through the days where we didn't have cut and paste on iOS.
Yeah, I didn't even have a BlackBerry. I had a flip out phone that had a little keyboard on it. It was fantastic.
You had that thing for years, dude. Mm-hmm. like since I first knew him to this year.
Yeah,
he's had this thing. Uh-huh. It's incredible.
Well, I remember watching him on Hold It Up in different podcasts, so I do remember it. I'm just in awe.
We all finally recall Mike's flip phone as he upgrades to the next generation.
I don't know where you are, fellow flip phone, but one love.
Somewhere a rat in New York City is chewing on it as we speak.
you're there, or it died in the cab and someone stole it and is now trying to find a plug ancient enough to charge that phone to open it.
Did you ever have to replace the battery in it so it would hold a charge?
I actually had an extra battery. I had, because I had one, and it got water damaged. So they wouldn't take it back. So I'm like, the battery's still good. So I took the battery out, and I kept an extra battery in my wallet. I always kept it charged. It was amazing. Like,
he had to figure it out.
I was very resourceful with it.
He's like, why move forward with technology? I got this down.
Yeah. I mean, I walked around my iPad everywhere, so I had like access to all the information I needed. It was just much easier to type.
Awesome. Awesome. Mike, it's time for that part of the show that I know is your favorite.
Sorg. Oh my God, Sorg. I've been dreaming about Slice on Broadway since the last time I had Slice on Broadway. And I had two slices immediately as I came down here, and the only reason I'm not eating them now is because I'm on camera and I would just devour the rest of the pie. I'm from New York, so I know what I'm talking about with pizza. Slice on Broadway is magnificent. It is fantastic. They will apparently also make you... What was the pizza that Katie got?
The Hello Kitty pizzas.
Hello Kitty
pizza. And they took two shots at it, too. One shaped like Hello Kitty. It was like a dough doll. And the other just with toppings in the shape of.
Yeah. And if you are in the Pittsburgh area, which I am currently in the Pittsburgh area, so I am enjoying Slice on Broadway. They also have a shop in Carnegie.
Mm-hmm.
I'm saying it your way.
Oh, you said it my way.
I'm
Thank
saying
you.
It your way. It's Carnegie.
That's our word.
It's Carnegie. It's Carnegie. Trust me. There's a hall. I know about this place.
There's a deli.
There's a deli. Oh, the deli. But anyway, this is about Slice on Broadway and how delicious it is. Actually, Carnegie Deli is closed.
Right now. Oh, is it?
Yeah, they had some zoning issues. We won't get into that. But Slice on Broadway, if you're in the Pittsburgh area, it's amazing. Follow Slice PGH on Twitters. And just tell them how much you love pizza. You can send them a pizza emoji app. I don't think that'll do anything. Except make them aware of your presence. But tell them Mad Mike sent you, and they won't know what that means, but they will appreciate it still, nonetheless.
I want to send them, actually, a tweet with just all pizza emojis and see what that does. See if they respond to me, you know. Let's see. Where do you find a pizza emoji?
It's under the food section.
It's under the food section. There's a food section to your emojis these days. That's pretty fantastic.
Of course. There's like a... Yet still no bacon emoji. It'll new come. iOS update, still no bacon emoji.
Well, Mike, in a little bit, we're going to talk about something that we've been using where you could upload your own bacon emoji to.
That would be very frightening.
Which I think once you find out about it, I think you're going to sign right up for it. But in the meantime, we have a couple other things to touch base on. Google, wait, this isn't the thing that I put. Hold on a second. Am I on the right app? Is this your tip of the week there, Chilla?
I'm sorry. I'm looking at flip phones. Hold on one second. I went totally into like a hole of old tech.
Chilla just went off the grid.
Literally
what here.
The tip of the week with Google Photos.
Yes.
Yes. So that is mine. I'm sorry. There was nothing there, so I put it in there.
Okay. Okay. I thought I put an app of the week, but I think I moved it till after this next break because I figured we go along with it. So the app of the week we'll talk about very soon, but this is your tip of the week.
So for the tip of the week, Google released an update to the Google Photos app. And one of the things that they're doing, especially if you're on an older phone or your device has low amounts of space, like a 16 gig iPhone, their app will actually prompt you and say, hey, we've backed up all your photos. Do you want us to delete them off this device? Which is interesting because I'm thinking... So Apple will let you store your photos up there and Google will back them up into Google Photos. And that's the one thing that I see people doing is they're snapping 8 pictures of the exact same thing in the exact same pose just to try to get a well-lit one and they never go back and delete it. Mm-hmm. So Google is going to prompt you to actually delete your photos off the device because you know you have a good backup. So it's an option to free up space. So I think that's pretty cool. The one thing that worries me about this is I hope they don't pull a Microsoft and like a year from now say, yeah, all that free space we gave you, that's all well and good, but you're going to have to either
remember when we told you to delete all your stuff? Yeah, you know what?
Now, if you want to keep it in Google Photos, you're going to have to pay for it. I hope they don't turn this into some kind of hostage situation.
But to be fair, they're not really known for that as much.
No.
So, like, Google usually won't do something like that unless everybody stops using Photos and they'll shut it down.
That's the only thing. First kind of phone I had. In the chat room, that they just posted a picture of what the first kind of phone I had looked like.
I'll see if I can pull it up here. What was it?
It looks like a Motorola. I think it was a Motorola.
Right,
yeah.
It's before the it was the first StarTAC.
Yeah.
Oh man.
Not the small StarTAC, the one before that.
My first was a Kyocera from Cricket.
Hmm. Well, I'm thinking now. I'm thinking. Well, I could get like a cellular enabled iPad. And leave the phone and just have my iPad everywhere with me.
Wait, what are you trying to do?
And go back to a flip phone.
You're trying
to pull a Mad Mike.
I'm going back.
Off the grid.
I'm not going off the grid. I'm going off your grid is basically what's happening.
Well, but I'd have an iPad. It would have all the connectivity on there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true.
I can connect to you over Hangouts. I can hit you up on Slack.
Yeah.
Wi-Fi is everywhere now.
So. Yeah. But I could even get a cellular enabled.
That's true.
But then you'll never not have your iPad on you.
And what's wrong with that?
I was going to say, do you always have it on you anyway?
For the most part.
Always have a bag on you? Aren't you in situations where you just don't want to have a bag?
No. What happens if I need something in my bag?
You always have... I forgot you have a kid, so you do always need a bag these days. Never mind. There's for those in the chat room on video, something like this is what you had. Mm-hmm. There you go.
Yeah, that was exactly the first flip phone
over the days.
T9 texting.
All right, we had some stuff come in today or this week from our friend Alex Kahrs out in California, and I need to download it. Okay,
interested in seeing it. Is this the video?
This is the video that he's talking about. First, first is email. About a week ago, I tried Boomerang app by Instagram. By the way, I'm having a lot of fun with it. Did you guys see what I made on there last week? I'll pull that up while I'm at it as well. And but anyways, yeah. So Boomerang is the app that Instagram brought up that does basically animate GIFs, so you can push those out. It was so much fun that I made one video after 8 takes and promptly deleted the app. I think I'll try it again when someone can explain the appeal. That said, I'm sending you the best video I can get out of the experience. Enjoy. And he sent a video here, and I'm going to try to open it up here in the quick time. But what did I do with it? So I found somebody left a paperclip on the table when I went to Orbis Cafe up in Mount Lebanon. Give them a little plug here. So I made this little flag kind of thing going on. Representing Sorgatron Media, so I hope you guys enjoyed
Did
that.
Did you stake your claim?
I staked my claim to this table and this coffee over there, so I had a little bit of fun with that. And the video he did...
That looks like an outtake from, like, Stick Stickly back in Nickelodeon.
It's 90s. A little bit, too, isn't it? I'm like, everybody's doing stop motion for the most part, you know? And I didn't preview this, so this was his... there you go. He's playing Flappy Birds on his Pebble Watch. So there you go. No, I think it's a fun app. It's not an app that I think you're going to go to like all the time. Like, I forget the layout app is on my phone until I hit the button in Instagram. Like, it's like that I'm in Facebook, I hit a button, it takes me to the other app that does the other function. Mm-hmm. So, like, you can just bury all that stuff somewhere.
Isn't that just kind of like the new pictures that the 6 Plus takes, though? Like where like it's essentially
so
a
the six,
a little bit.
So the 6S and 6S Plus take a small, it's constantly recording a second and a half. So when you take the photo, you get the second and a half before and the second and a half after. So it's a 3 hour It's a 3 second video clip in addition to the still frame that you took.
Okay.
Boomerang takes is it a one second or second and a half clip?
Something like that. Yeah, it's like a second.
It takes a second and a half clip, plays it forward, and then takes the second and a half and plays it in reverse to create a 3 second clip.
Okay.
But it's forward and then back.
Gotcha.
So if you had, where I think this is kind of, can be kind of funny is if you had like someone going through a revolving door, or you had someone throwing a tennis ball against the wall and it comes back and hits them in the head.
Mm-hmm.
Like, cause it would make that look.
Or if you want to pretend like you know how to throw a boomerang. You
can... Yes. And then it would come back.
It would come back. Otherwise it's just a stick.
So that's where I think it's interesting. The thing that I think that you have to put the thought process into Boomerang is you have to think about those moments of when you want to use it. I almost feel like Boomerang is better for, I have a clip of video that had a second that was funny in it, and I just want to take that second and play it forward and reverse out of this 45 second clip that I just took.
You're there, or you happen to be like researching who killed JFK.
Yes.
So it's like back and to the left, back and to the left.
But I feel like there's a lot of planning that needs to take place to use something like Boomerang, or a lot of precursory setup and setting up how you're going to take this video. It's not
like just like a more punctuated vine. Yeah. But like also in reverse.
Yes. But I think it takes more planning and preparation. It's not something you're going to be like, oh, I'm going to use this to take a video of something on the fly.
Right. Yeah, it's kind of hard. It's like, oh, this is the thing I could do. You know, like that. Like I set that up, blew on the thing, and took a picture. You know, and that's what came out of it. And I actually have a couple of them. There's one like next to a podcamp pen. It's on my Facebook. And it's nice. It's just not just for Instagram. It also sent one to my Facebook. And I think you could do Twitter as well, if I'm not mistaken. So I think it's kind of nice. So, but no, thank you, Alex, for dropping a line on that and that he experimented with that a little bit. So, okay, guys, speaking of experimentation. No, that's a bad one. So we do a lot of podcasts. We do a lot of video production. Actually, very neck deep. You can check out right now something we're way, you know, we don't just do podcasts. You know, you don't just do podcasts around here. Is that clear?
Don't?
Is that clear that we do some other stuff too around here? But we're actually involved in, I've been doing the editing for a campaign going on right now from the Pittsburgh Foundation called papeoplecount.org. That you can go check that out. Actually, a great hand in editing some of the videos over there. In particular, talking about the PA state budget crisis and kind of what it's doing to a lot of services here in the state. If you're not in Pennsylvania, you probably don't care as much, but it's a very interesting thing that's happening. But this is something where we're helping to spread the word and tell the politicians and hopefully get past this to help out some of the people here in PA. Having a big part of that, we do a lot of video production around here, doing some marketing videos and helping with social media and getting other companies into podcasting, like our friends at fishingwithoutbait.com, for instance. There's a plug there if you want to check that out and find out what exactly we're talking about over there. You can check out all that stuff and the future site as soon as we get some stuff on the back end done over at sidekickmediaservices.com. There's a cool little demo reel so you can see a little bit of the variety of things that we've done, you know, around these podcasts and for clients and all over the place over the last several years represented here. So if you need help, if your company needs to get some media done, some video, some production, something of the sort, let us know, sidekickmediaservices.com. And hit us up, and we'll help you out. So let's take a look at what happened last week in SorgatronMedia.com, where we're producing these fine, fine shows, and Something with a Hobo. We'll be right back.
All of the Android Priv Instagram photos with funny captions that other people made up.
Maybe I laugh and smile and order a bunch more pillows on my phone, and this relationship will become bearable.
You give me a tiny person? What's wrong with his arms? He's got lines sticking out of his arms.
Matt Carlin, our friend in the mainstream media, is doing a real great job case here. And it's also a very visual kind of thing. So you can get a nice... There's a chick just getting blasted in the face. There you go. I don't even know where that was or who that was, but you can go explore it over on indiewrestling.us/blog. We are back. It's the AwesomeCast, and man, things got a little bit weird last week, but go check out that. So much more. SorgatronMedia.com. We got into an app this past week obviously we're doing a lot of things, you know, Sidekick Media Services, Sorgatron Media, AwesomeCast, Wrestling Mayhem Show, and we need to, I was recognizing the need that we need to organize a little bit more, because I realized I was talking about all these things over on Chilla. I was just talking with him beforehand. I usually coordinate with him if he's going to be in studio over direct message on Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
Yet Katie, who I have on regularly, I'm doing it in messages or in or email sometimes, right? Mike, you know, we were doing, you know, Wrestling Mayhem Show. I was trying to use a Facebook chat for that for a little bit. We try to coordinate something happening over this past weekend over there. And one, gifts get a little out of control. Can we agree on that?
A little bit. Yeah, the fact that you can literally just click and add things kind of dilutes the conversation, so to speak.
Mm-hmm. A little bit. But yeah. And to the point where I'm worried that, like, the important information is kind of getting lost in the tomfoolery that's happening. And I keep hearing about this thing called Slack. On a lot of my productivity podcasts, on tech podcasts, so the businesses are using them, right? And I remember when I had the 9-to-5er, like, we did all of our communication, inter-office communication, on AOL Instant Messenger. So not quite as secure or anything like that. What's happening over there?
So Chilla found a way to put gifts on Slack.
Oh, no. All right. Well, gifts are not the primary reason that we would have a problem.
It's like, as you were saying it, he was looking through different categories.
And,
like,
and,
I wonder if I can just drag this down here.
And yeah, a very appropriate, gif as well over there. Thanks, Chilla. Thanks for that.
Well, and it was funny because actually what got me started, let's finish the Slack thing and then I'll digress into animated GIFs.
Okay.
So let's continue. Sorry, oh. I didn't mean to move us past Slack because I'm loving Slack.
Mm-hmm.
But I could definitely now see myself putting a lot of GIFs in there.
Let's keep that in the general. Okay, so here's what we've done here. If you're on video, you can kind of see our organization. At least, like, the initial, what I'm trying to do here. Like, I really just kind of went in and listed all the kind of properties we're working with. The websites, the events, the podcasts, and inviting people in. And, again, if you're familiar with Twitter and how Facebook works, it's really, you really get it right off the bat, right? At replies work. Hashtags, if you use a hashtag for these channels in here, like, we have a hashtag for AwesomeCast. If I typed it in here, that is now clickable. And now here's your AwesomeCast stuff.
Now, here was one thing I was wondering is, so I know I can create a channel, a new channel, mm-hmm. and I can make it public or I can make it private and I can invite others or whatever. If I hashtag a channel that doesn't exist, does it auto-create the channel? I don't know.
I'm going to try it.
Hashtag fun with GIFs.
And we go to general, and
no, it does not occur.
No, it has to be something
that has to be something that exists. So that's good, but that's a good thing, right?
Right, because how many channels will we freaking have in here? but it's nice because, and again, you don't see all the channels like that I have over here. You see the channels that you belong to. So you see AwesomeCast, you see general, you see random, because I think general and random, everybody belongs to. That's kind of it's the courtyard, it's that kind of stuff. And then we can bury it down and say, okay, let's have the conversation over here about AwesomeCast. Let's have the conversation over here about what we're going to do for Chachi Plays. Even to a certain point, I just dropped in ideas I have for Chachi Plays. Now, why is this different? Why is this different than just using Facebook Messenger? Well, now it's searchable and it is free. And I believe that it keeps your last 10,000 messages or something like that if it's free. So you do have to, if we have a bunch of people in here, we might have to start paying for it just to make sure we retain everything. And there's extra features and privacy that you can get into. But if you're a small group that just needs to organize like an event or something, or you have a couple projects together, this is going to be really nice for free to try this out. Has apps on everything. There's a Windows app. There's a Windows Phone app, I think. There's a Mac Store app, like you were talking mm-hmm. about getting.
So I just downloaded that, and it works. It's interesting to see the parallels, but it does. The UI is obviously tailored to the device you're using. Mm-hmm. So keep that in mind. I think everything's there on every device. It's just where it's at is a little bit different.
Right, right.
It takes a little bit of getting
used to. I think you're going to get that. You're going to get that, though. Then I've noticed, because I threw it on my Windows 10 device as well, and I think it's pretty comparable when you look at these. So, but yeah, and here's all the Wrestling Mayhem Show stuff. We haven't really gotten too deep in any conversation that I'm worried about. And then Chill's sharing interesting pictures with me, and he's making where he's Tony Stark, and, you know, stuff like that. But also the integration. I can't remember where I put it. I think it was in general. Maybe it was Mayhem Show. But there's integration for stuff like, you know, Dropbox, for Google Drive, you know, brings you right into your stuff there. And there's the services that it lists are plentiful. I haven't heard of half of this stuff. So if you configure your integrations, which is apparently on the site itself, we'll pop that up. Yeah, again, I don't know what half of this stuff is, to be honest. You know, AirBreak, AppSignal, Blossom. A lot of these are like for video meetings and devices. I noticed on Google Hangouts, it says you can actually bring your conversations, like, so you can have a clickable into a Google Hangout on here, which, Mike, that might be helpful for when you're doing Google Hangout shows. Okay. So, I mean, you know, again, just putting the link in there, we'll take it to,
that'd even be nice for AwesomeCast to kick off the show in that way instead of having to call everybody.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Just put a link in there and say, hey, click in when you're ready.
Yeah.
But I don't know. But do we want every guest in here as well? Is the other question.
That's true. Well, I would say, here's the link for everybody. Once we have everyone in, then you would call the guest.
That's true, too.
Tap the guest in. I don't know. It's just an idea.
Yeah. And it's the other, like, what is the use case here? And we can't do private channels because there's some things, you know, talking with the business, I might not want everybody to be able to find in mm-hmm. there, you know? So we can privatize that a little bit, too, if we're talking about, like, financials or something like that I don't want to talk about for real. You know, it seems like it gets most of the stuff done. So my other thing is I want to integrate this a little bit more, and I want to and by the way, Chachi just quit because you put an anime gif in here, by the way.
He quits everything because I was gonna say,
Chachi quits at least three times
a week. Was a test. It's not like I kept I can continue to drag more in. here we go, Chachi. This one's for you.
but no, I think it's a nice little it's a nice inter-office communication thing. What is this? What am I looking at here? It's not even is it's oh, a, it's now a, you have to now you have to
GIF.
You have to actually click on it in order for it to GIF though. So that's kind of nice. Oh, and you can actually go through all the pictures in there. So that's kind of nice. Sad to see Chachi go. Well, there you go. You see what trouble you can get into. But again, and then it's not in Facebook. If you're worried about putting things in Facebook, now who's Slack? You can read into it. I think they have more privacy in general and better policies. Everybody seems to be using it on a business level, so there must be a bit of a familiarity with it. This is the kind of thing that when you talk about Facebook Business, they're trying to compete with.
Yeah.
Is this kind of system for business. So again, we're only a couple days into it. We'll see how it goes. Chachi's already out, apparently. I wonder if every time I mention Chachi says if he gets an alert on his phone. Yes, probably.
But you know what? If Chachi quits something, you know it has to be pretty viable. Because he... I mean, you know, he generally always comes back to the stuff that he quits, so it sticks around.
That's true.
I mean, look, he went back to Plurk.
He went back to NXT.
Went back to NXT.
See?
He has an iPhone, but work made him. He has a Mac. I gave him the Mac.
He went back to Xbox
One. Oh, see, he's already back.
See?
All right.
Other We're than going missing, back on the grid.
But also, also really nice is we have our own domain. So it's like, hey, if you want to get on this, like it's sorgatronmedia.slack.com. And I wonder what happens if you're not on there. I think it does it ask for a login? And I think you can only let certain people. Oh, and this is nice because I invited somebody and I used their work email. It's a domain like, you know, complete blah, blah, bank.com, right? And I'll notice that it's not like Gmail or something. So if I set everybody up with a sorgatronmedia.com email address, I can say whitelist anybody from this address.
That's nice.
Because obviously if they have a sorgatronmedia.com or this other company, and I say, well, anybody from that company, I want a part of this. And now you don't have to worry about that. And it's wide open to them. So so that's if you're, you know, using your own email versus Gmail, Yahoo, something like that. So worth checking out. I don't know. You guys have any other thoughts on it a little bit that with Chilla that you've used it so far?
I'm really, really enjoying it. To me, bringing the group together is more of a community.
Right.
This just makes, to me, perfect sense.
And that's the thing. I want to bring this whole, like, all of us collaborating into one place. I was trying to do this with Coffee Club.
Yeah.
You know, now we can kind of do this as a whole for the most
part. Still, don't get me wrong, I still like the idea for Coffee Club and actually getting together.
Which I'm actually looking to bring that back, by the way.
I like this because I can check in on it through the day or once a day or once every other day. But if someone mentions me, I get an alert.
Right.
I can kind of get alerted just on certain channels. Like, I can kind of customize it for my need. The other thing that I really like about this was I noticed as soon as I signed in and said, send me notifications on my phone, I got an email that said, phone notifications have been enabled, emails have been disabled. So I'm not inundated.
Nice.
Not inundated on every platform that someone posted something in a different section. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that's what drives me nuts about Facebook.
Yeah.
Is it's like I get a notification on my phone, then I get an email that I got a message. Like I get it 52 different ways and times. Across all the devices and all the email boxes and everything else that I really enjoyed. I'm like, wow, Slack got it. Like, I only need to be notified once. I don't need to be inundated.
It also seems like it'd be good for, like, multitasking and, like, integrating over the different shows. Like, just in case someone from the Mayhem Show decides to be on AwesomeCast. Or someone from AwesomeCast is on the Mayhem Show or Boss
Battle. Right, and you can drop in. And I don't know, is it easy to leave channels as well, I would imagine? So like Mike, if you're on AwesomeCast, you can drop into that and see what we've been talking about lately around the show and know what's going on there. And then just kind of, okay, I'm done. Now I don't think I can because I'm kind of like the master user on here.
Mm-hmm. You can leave the channel.
You can leave the channel. So that means like you won't get updates anymore from that channel.
Where I like about it too is if someone wants to drop into AwesomeCast and say, hey, I saw this article, thought you guys might be interested. Or Boss Battle, I may see someone for video games and say, just drop in a link and say, hey, I don't know if you guys were going to talk about this, but I thought this was pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel like it helps generate additional content that others may not have seen.
Right. And even like a little bit of, say not just for podcasts, like I said, I'm going to try to use it for the collaboration. There's a documentary we're trying to work on. And I actually had been talking with one person. I was trying to get me some contacts with people. And now I'm working with somebody else that's been helping me on another aspect of it. And I realized I hadn't gotten those two people together yet to talk about the documentary. So I invited them both in and threw them on a channel on here. And it's like, well, let's see what happens. So, and especially since they're both in very different but similar in industries, I'm hoping to see them kind of gel a little bit. So I think it'll be nice in general. So, we'll be poking at this. I'm sure we'll have some Slack stories after a few weeks here as we go and kind of keep you updated on that. I have a feeling I'm probably going to do an episode after about a week or so on this on basic sorgonomics as far as my findings on it so far, using it in the kind of environment that we're using it for. And you mentioned there is like, so you talked about if like your company starts using this that you work for in your day job, there is like a pretty simple app switching or domain switching basically, because you'd be going to yourcompany.slack.com instead and logging in there and it'd be separated a little bit. But it seems to do that in the apps. So what was your issue with GIFs?
Oh, it wasn't an issue with GIFs. So one of the things that you were talking about was, you wouldn't give up Chrome because of your GIF plugin thing?
Okay, and I know that's a silly thing.
But no, it's not. It's a legitimate need
for everyone, unless you're Chachi. Mm-hmm. But there's actually the GIF keyboard application. There's actually a GIF here. I'm going to turn my computer around so you can see it at least.
Okay.
There's a GIF app for macOS that puts it up in your toolbar, and then you can drag the GIF into anything.
I wonder if there's
a GIF app on this. It's searchable. There's a keyboard.
Yeah. I'm going to have to do some looking.
Yeah, there's a GIFy keyboard that you can just like click a thing. Like when you go to the emojis, you'll go to basically GIFy search.
Oh.
Yes.
And then you can just do that. I need to install that.
So this and the cool thing about this is it works across any application. Then it's not just in Chrome necessarily. Kind of as a Chrome plugin. This lets you kind of pull it across.
And installing.
You just doing GIFy keyboard?
Yep.
I'm realizing I need to do that too. That's thank you, Mac. But then the problem is, but you see how many computers are in front of me?
I only have 10 fingers, Sorg.
So it's not everywhere that I am quite as much. But again, iOS, I have to do something different anyways. So, that's not my biggest holdup. Actually, I've had, I've been having issues on a couple computers where Chrome is just dragging them to the bottom.
And so it'll be interesting
to see. I've been Firefoxing it on a couple of computers lately.
I've heard Chrome's going to make an announcement soon, and they're going to start to drop support for older OSs.
Yeah, goodbye Windows XP, apparently coming up in April.
And I heard older versions of Mac OS.
Older versions. Up to Mountain Lion.
Okay.
Like, all the lions are going to be gone. Which, that seems weird, because that's not nearly as old.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like there might be a few people still on a lion or a mountain lion.
Yeah, but I think that the issue, going back to a lion or a mountain lion, means your hardware has to be, and I actually just looked this up for someone at work. You could have a mid-2007 MacBook Pro and still get to El Capitan.
That is true. That is true. There's not as big of an issue there.
So I think
this is a 2007 iMac in front of me, and it's running El Capitan now.
Yeah, so the hardware could be 8 years old. And still,
you don't have an excuse because it's just an update.
Yeah, it's a free OS update,
right?
Versus a lot of people that are running older OSs because the hardware actually can't run anything more.
Right. I mean, well, we've seen that over the years, and now that's sort of changing with Windows 10. Mm-hmm. But people still have that mindset of like, you know, we're just getting to the point where people are starting to kill support for Windows 7 on a regular basis.
Mm-hmm.
Just getting to that point. Maybe just because Windows 10 seems like a more viable option, and it just got to SP1, which I've not installed yet.
I did. I have had zero issues.
Or maybe I have and I didn't realize it.
That was the weird thing is that it just looks like an update. It looks like
So I might have when I wasn't looking. Hold on. How do I tell?
Oh, actually,
I don't know.
I think mine. You don't have updated.
Nobody knows anymore.
Go in and see. Do you have update? Do you have available updates?
I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know how this thing. Computers are hard, man.
If only there was some kind of tech podcast you could listen to.
I know. That's such a good idea, man. You know, and I used to know Windows like the back of my hand, and now it's just I don't
see the thing that stinks is for me for work. Windows 10 doesn't work with our VPN yet, so I can't upgrade the majority of my machines to Windows 10. So I'm stuck at Windows 7 for now. But I'm guessing it would be, for me, on the one Windows 10 machine I have at home, I just looked in my updates and I had updates pending and I ran them. Mm-hmm. And then poof, I was at the new.
Let's see. People around me have been cursing at super long update cycles on their computers in the last week. I bet SP just got downloaded on all their computers. Yep. All right. Anyways, let's get back to the show. And my notes won't load.
That was one of your show notes was Windows 10 update makes activation easier.
Right.
And enhances Cortana and Edge.
Apparently, you can upgrade if you have your key from Windows 8 or 8.1 or maybe even 7.
I think it goes back to 7.
It will retro upgrade your Windows 10 if you install it from scratch. So there's that.
And once you install, and this is the coolest part, I think, once you install it once on that hardware, you never need the key again.
Right.
Because it registers the hardware profile based on your account and the hardware itself.
So it just needs to touch base online. It sees that profile and you're good.
Yep.
Yep. So as long as you don't change like a bunch of stuff in that computer, you're good to go.
Yeah.
So that might be nice. So I have like an upgrade disk for Windows 7. That's kind of been around the bend a little bit. So maybe if I drop that key on one of the computers, it might just give me Windows 10. Maybe. Sort of.
As long as the key's not overused.
Probably, yeah, to be honest. We'll see. Let's throw Windows 10 on this MacBook and see what happens. But no, really cool that that's happening. And of course, I don't know if we talked about much on here about how eventually you need to be careful, because if you have Windows 7 or 8, you may just wake up with Windows 10 one day.
And that's going to start next. That's going more, I think, into next year. Because I actually had to. I went to all my machines at home and made sure that this wasn't going to happen to me by the end of year.
And I need to do this on my studio computer to make sure it doesn't upgrade when I'm not looking. I don't even want to do. I get nervous when it's just doing system updates.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because I'm afraid it's going to break something the next time I come down here. I think it's good for the majority of people.
And for the majority of people, once you get to 10, it's going to stop being an option.
Right. It's that leap from whatever to 10. Because I've had a computer that upgraded, and it was not a great idea. It's slogging pretty good. It's the AMD 64 one, you know? I was like, yeah, it's got gave me the option. Why not? Let's do this. I don't know. We'll see what happens with that. I'm sure we're going to hear a lot of gnashing of teeth over it in about a year here. So, okay, back to this. Okay, I had to share this. Now, I don't want to get political on here. I'm not taking sides or anything, but this was too good to pass up. So I'm not taking any side. I hate both sides. We're just going with that, okay? The recent debates, which have been entertaining to begin with, from what I understand, I don't know, I don't watch the news. The Democrats are fighting back after the GOP declares Wi-Fi discovery war, is the story from The Verge. So apparently, during the debates, the Republican National Committee set the media Wi-Fi password as Stop Hillary for the fourth GOP debate last week. Now, in response, the Democrats at their debate, was that Saturday night, I believe?
Yes.
They decided to make the network 13 million new jobs, the name of the network. And no password, but they did have a note by it, which said the Democratic Party is a party of inclusion, and we believe in expanding access and economic opportunity for all. No password. You're good. So a very interesting response to that. It's kind of fun, a little bit of a tech dig there happening on that level. So we'll be very careful what tech angles we bring from the elections in the next year and a half. So our year, is it a year? Yeah, it is a year, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Huh. Also, hey, ABC is developing exclusive shows for its Watched ABC app.
They're not the first network to do that.
They're not, but I don't think the Watch ABC app has really done much yet. I think they just have announced they're going to start a $4 service to get on there. And, of course, Star Trek is going to have a new series on the ABC All Access that's already out there for $6 a month that we've talked about as well. You're going to have a lot of choices.
CW has one, too.
Okay.
CW's free, though.
Yeah, that's true.
It's completely free.
Yeah. I mean, there's the CBS All Access is like them trying to do their own Hulu service for CBS programming.
I don't think it's a good idea.
You'd have to be a real big fan of CBS.
Yeah. You
can be a big fan of Star Trek. In addition to the new show, which they're going to air once on TV. And then all the rest of the episodes are going to be on All Access.
So once all the episodes come out, I can pay $6
and binge them. Exactly.
And then get off the network.
And watch all the old Star Trek stuff, too. They have every old Star Trek series is on there as well. So that's why I say if you like Star Trek, you want to binge that. It's $6 a month. you're good to go, right?
So. Yeah, I'm just as the first couple companies start to do this, I think it's going to be okay. I can do. I'll handle this.
Mm-hmm.
But then as okay, I'm paying $6 for this, and I'm paying $6 for that, and
right,
I'm paying $4
right.
for this. I might as well buy cable.
Right. I mean, that's the thing. I mean, you're going to say, well, what am I really watching? And I think you're going to be able to gauge that a little better there. Like Hulu, I turn off Hulu during the summer because it's like, well, I can watch Comedy Central Daily Show online anyways,
mm-hmm.
so or in the app or whatever. So why am I even bothering with this? So I cut that off, but during like the fall season when I don't want to fuss around with things and I want to watch my Arrow and my Flash and my Gotham and my Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and whatever else is on, it's worth the paying $12 so I have no ads.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, if it gets to a point and as they're threatening that they're going to make like a little tougher for us to watch these shows on Hulu and Netflix, like all the providers are basically saying we're considering them as competition and renegotiating our plans. If you know, like Arrow and Flash might be harder to see on Hulu and Netflix in the coming years. If that happens, then you better believe I'm setting up a DVR and taking my free over-the-air connection and just setting that up instead of paying for them. It's like, fine, if you don't want my money, I have other means to do it that are completely legal.
Well, the kicker is the CW, even especially for the CW, where their stuff's like a week behind.
Mm-hmm.
So you're not getting it next day, but it's a week behind, but it's free.
Yeah.
So that's where, I mean, and that's what got me onto the CW app, the fact that it was free.
But you do have to be careful because if you're like, hey, some of us are busy and, geez, we haven't watched Arrow for a couple weeks because they're just, like, I don't know when I'm watching stuff this week. Like, this is the way the schedule is. I might have time Saturday, but probably not. And that's it. I might not have any time until Thanksgiving weekend.
Well, CW, I think most of their back catalog's there.
Is it?
I think they go back, like, I want to say 2-3 episodes.
Yeah, it's multiple episodes.
Right. And as I was telling you on the CBS All Access, they are currently showing, you have to pay to get the recent episode of Supergirl, but you can freely watch in Chromecast last week's episode.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm good. I have no immediacy. I'm not listening to the Supergirl spoiler talking Supergirl podcast or anything like that.
You're not on the Slack channel, obviously.
I believe that is called the Kryptonium Wears Prada podcast. Org. I'm kidding. I just made that up.
Hey, but somebody better be doing that now. Coming soon to the Sorgatron Media Network.
The Kryptonium Wears Prada.
There you go. All right. Other than that, Democrats, Google does stuff. Hey, if you want to make some money, be awesome at Google's local guide. And they'll give you a free, I thought they were giving you money, but they're also giving you a free terabyte of cloud storage. Also, great that I got a tech story from Stuff Magazine, I noticed here. Thank you, Apple News. But
I didn't know Stuff Magazine was still a thing.
Apparently, and it's an Apple News and they talk about Google. So whatever happened there.
Okay.
Everyone
loves the Goog, Sorg.
Everybody loves the Goog, that's right.
Even Apple.
That's right. Yeah. And Chilla, what is taking Arial to the next level?
So we were talking about the Arial screensaver
last
week.
Which is playing on two of my computers over here, by the way. I love it. It soothes me during the podcast, to be honest.
There's another screensaver module. I'm guessing since Arial started to get kind of a bunch of recognition, I've seen like a bunch of different, hey, look, now that you like that screensaver, go look at this screensaver. Well, there's one called Save Hollywood, which actually takes and lets you point the screensaver at any video.
Really?
On your and it'll loop it. Which I thought was pretty cool. And the one thing that it'll do as well is you can actually say like mute the sound or play closed caption or whatever. So if you wanted to set like a bunch of different a movie up as your screensaver, so when you weren't using a specific computer, it would just play this movie on a loop with closed captions, boom, there you go.
Huh.
I thought it was a neat little idea. Or if you wanted to take all your Sorgatron Media intros, like all the different intros, and paste them together into one long thing.
Or a demo reel at a conference or at a table or something like that. Mm-hmm. That could be fun.
And just set that up as a screensaver on a loop, so when you're not using the computer, it just sits there in place.
Yeah. Use those screens.
Mm-hmm.
Use those screens. Maximize that screen ability.
So, what I thought was neat too was that you can queue up a bunch of movies in a row, play them in a random order. You can do different things. Like I said, you can mute it normal, custom audio or custom audio level, which display it plays on, that kind of thing. So neat little thing called Save Hollywood.
Awesome. Go check that out. Okay. Well, it's been a fun time. Mad Mike at Mad Mike 4883. Somebody hire this guy. Get him to Pittsburgh.
Actually, multiple people hire me.
What?
Multiple.
Are you just gonna work 24 hours a day?
Sure.
I've done it before. Happen. Gonna work hard.
Mm-hmm.
And have to quit the wrestling podcast because it's working so hard.
No, I will just do the podcast on my many lunch hours. Sword.
There you go. They build them up. You just build them up. At Chilla on the Twitter as well.
John's Chilla on the Facebooks. If anyone out there gets the Microsoft phone, which is being released on AT&T in 3 days, let me know. I'm interested to hear feedback.
There you go. And, of course, AwesomeCast.net is where you can find this and all of our interviews and stuff. Like I said, check out the Tech Shop interview that we did this past week and so much more. And I can't remember what we did last week. Oh, check out the Looking for Group one because we're probably going to be talking about it on Boss Battle because a few of us did get down there and play some Xbox. And you can check out our conversation with them a week after they opened. So shout outs to them, lfgpgh.com, for more information if you're in the Pittsburgh area, especially in the Brookline neighborhood. Thank you, everybody. Thank you to our awesome chat room that's been rocking all night. I see a bunch of people coming in for the wrestling shows, but Wheels has been in there. Crazy Krause, Juggalo John, and, of course, Missy on the ones and twos, helping with the community and the show notes and tweets all night long. Live.sorgatronmedia.com every Tuesday at 6:30, 7 p.m. Eastern is around the start time. And even earlier, a lot of times we have the awesome chat interviews. Subscribe to us, audio, video versions. Please, especially, go look for us on the AwesomeCast iTunes and leave a rating. Even just leave a star. Just click on the star. Hopefully the 5-star, but click on one of them. It helps out greatly. And, of course, also patreon.com/AwesomeCast. Thank you so much for joining us. You have been our awesome audience. Awesome week.
This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.